So where have we come to now? First, the Gospels describe a world that did actually exist, and Jesus was a real historical figure. The Gospels are not pure myth. But equally, the Gospels are not pure history either. They must not be read uncritically. What we have to do, if we want to reconstruct the life of Jesus, is put together the various bits of the jigsaw. Ancient Jewish history, archaeology, gospel criticism, and then see what kind of reconstruction of the historical Jesus himself we can produce. Of course, in these matters, we're dealing only with probabilities, never with certainties. And you may be surprised by how much of the traditional account we've decided to leave out. Nevertheless, we believe we can offer a credible answer to the question, who was Jesus? The life of the historical Jesus began not in Bethlehem, but in the northern province of Galilee, at Nazareth, a small hill town of a kind that still exists today. The area had a reputation for producing religious nonconformists and unsuccessful messiahs. Jesus' parents' names were Mary and probably Joseph. They had a family of five sons and several daughters. The Jews place a high value on family life, and all children are expected to marry. But we know of many people in Jesus' time who chose to remain celibate for various religious reasons. And Jesus later required his own disciples to abandon their families. So our presumption must be that he never married. The family business was apparently building, and Jesus probably learnt the highly respected trade of a carpenter. Jesus was not an Eastern ascetic who turns away from this world as illusory, nor did he hold the later Christian belief that final perfection can only be attained in a heaven beyond this world altogether. Like his contemporaries, he saw the goal of history as a transformed state of this created world, the reign of God on earth. So the work of shepherds and ploughmen was for him an appropriate source of metaphors for the new age he believed to be dawning. His outlook was both totally God-centered and very this-worldly. It came naturally to him to express his demand for a complete break with the past in a saying such as, "When you're ploughing, don't look back." The new age was to be a time of joy and conviviality. Because the reign of God was arriving, he could feast with publicans and sinners. But because its claims overrode everything else, he could demand total renunciation for its sake. Hopes of the dawn of the new age were common at that period, but Jesus' distinctive message took shape after his encounter with John the Baptist, a Judean prophet who emerged from the desert in about the year 28. Jesus and other Galileans traveled down the Jordan Valley to hear him. John was demanding that the nation must repent and be baptized. Since baptism was for Gentile converts, this was tantamount to saying that the existing religious system had failed. Jesus underwent John's baptism in the Jordan and was profoundly affected. One mark of the arrival of the kingdom of God was to be the pouring out of the divine spirit. Receiving the spirit, Jesus knew the kingdom was dawning and his life task was to launch it. The time of universal salvation had come. Leaving John, Jesus returned to Capernaum, a fishing village on the shores of Lake Galilee.
His sense of urgency is shown by the fact that he didn't set up a school or a desert community, but directly summoned disciples to join him as a wandering preacher. He probably took 12 to represent the 12 tribes. They were the nucleus of the kingdom. Almost all were Galileans, and the senior ones, Simon Peter, Andrew, James, and John, were fishermen. The company wandered from town to town around and across the lake. Sometimes, it's said, he taught from a boat. He used a mixture of parables, rhythmic verses, and short epigrams. The leading themes of the teaching were the kingdom's hidden reality, secret growth, sudden eruption, and certain triumph. A prayer he's said to have taught his disciples sums up his message. Father, thy name be hallowed, thy kingdom come, give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins.
Jesus' message in these early days of his Galilean preaching was very simple and terrifyingly demanding. The good news was that the kingdom of God was coming. But unless you responded immediately to the invitation, you were lost. It was no use being unprepared like the foolish bridesmaids, or making excuses like the guests who didn't want to come to the feast just yet. The call of the kingdom was so imperative, it even took precedence over a sacred duty like burying the dead. People have argued endlessly about the ethics of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus envisaged a world in which there'd no longer be the impulse to retaliate, to dominate, to exploit, to oppress. Did he really think this was possible? Of course he did. It's impossible in the old world, but in the new coming world, it's going to be the norm. Jesus envisaged a total transformation of human nature as a real coming possibility.
But the coming of the new world was fiercely opposed by powers which held suffering humanity in their grip. As the kingdom bearer, Jesus felt himself to be involved in an apocalyptic last battle against evil. Hence the tradition that meeting a leper, he flared up with anger as he sensed the presence of the enemy. His healings and exorcisms were not just medical acts, they were acts of salvation, victories over evil forces. If I, by the finger of God, cast out demons, he said, know that the kingdom of God has come upon you. Healings and exorcisms were not uncommon events in those days. What was distinctive about Jesus' healings was the meaning he gave them. The present synagogue at Capernaum was built in the 3rd century on the foundations of the one Jesus knew. Synagogue religion was much more to his taste than temple religion, and for some time at least he could speak publicly here at the services. A good deal in his message was not far removed from normal synagogue teaching. But, as he said, a prophet is without honor in his own country.
How did it come about that Jesus was criticized here on his own home territory? The stricter religious people, the Pharisees, thought he was lax in his observance of religious law. He ate with sinners, he didn't bother too much about their washing before meals, and he criticized the food laws. He differed from the Pharisees about Sabbath observance and about fasting. He freely promised God's forgiveness to all and sundry, and he paid no proper respect to traditional religious expertise. But more than that, perhaps more provoking, was his deliberate challenge to conventional religious assumptions. Most people thought, as they always do think, that the way to please God is by piling up merit, by being observant, by deserving God's favor. Whereas Jesus told stories about the undeserving, stories about erratic employers, about the hated Samaritans, about dishonest bailiffs, and so on. Now, it wasn't that he was a masochist, in love with suffering, or that he thought somehow being defiled was a good thing. The point was that these people had the necessary receptivity. Jesus was saying that they knew their need, and the kingdom of God is not for people who feel they deserve it, but for people who know their profound and total need of it.
Jesus' unconventional behavior had made him unpopular. People called him a glutton and a drunk, the friend of publicans and sinners. It was even said that he was in league with the devil. He may have been driven south from Galilee by plots and threats from Herod Antipas. But he retorted, "Go and tell that fox, today and tomorrow I shall be casting out devils and healing. On the third day I reach my goal." That is, Herod could not deflect him from his destiny. His group was larger by now and included several women who contributed to their support. They made their way down the Jordan Valley and on towards Jerusalem.
But why did he do it? What sense of destiny drove him on? For Jesus, Jerusalem was the center of his faith, the city of God, and therefore it was also the cockpit of the historic struggle between God and Israel. Like the prophets before him, he had to appear in the capital, present his message to the nation's leaders, and they would reject it. That was the eternal pattern, now about to be replayed for the last time. This coming final confrontation was written deep in the nation's history.
After Bethany, where Jesus probably had sympathizers and could lodge, the road runs down the Mount of Olives, where, according to tradition, the Messiah would stand on the last day, and then past Gethsemane, before going across the Kidron Valley and then up to the city. Pilgrims on the road sang the customary psalms. If they carried palm branches, then it was presumably to attend the Feast of Tabernacles, or the Feast of the Dedication of the Temple. Walking into Jerusalem, what did Jesus have to set against that mighty establishment? Nothing but the idea of a God who comes to save the worthless and the despised. Some of Jesus' followers probably saw him as the Messiah, coming to claim his kingdom. Whether he thought this, we don't know. The stories of his entry into the city and cleansing of the temple have been elaborated by later faith. But the main points are clear. The hour of the kingdom had come, and the temple was to be challenged. He came up these steps.
In the classic tradition of the prophets of Israel, the temple itself was the preeminent sign of God's kingdom. It was a house of prayer for all nations. It was a light to the Gentiles. But when Jesus came here, he thought he found nothing but established privilege, buying and selling in the temple precincts. The temple just turned into a profitable business. His condemnation was unsparing. The temple was supposed to be devoutly awaiting the kingdom of God. Instead, it was diametrically opposed to all that Jesus stood for. So he pronounced God's judgment on the temple, and the temple made up its mind about him.
At their Last Supper, Jesus linked the Passover hope with his own death, and by sharing the cup, bound his disciples to share his own fate. First, the cup of bitterness, then, in the kingdom, the cup of blessing. After the meal, the company left the city to keep vigil under the paschal moon at Gethsemane on the Mount of Olives. Though just opposite the temple, it's still a wild place, even today. It was probably common knowledge that Jesus was a wanted man. At this moment, his hopes for the kingdom and his dread of the coming ordeal were both at their highest pitch. A force which included Roman soldiers and temple police arrested Jesus after a scuffle. Jesus was betrayed by one of his followers and deserted by the rest. And the use of weapons may have sealed his fate. As Jesus was hurried through the darkened streets, one disciple, Peter, seems to have recovered himself enough to return and follow. At the house of the high priest, Caiaphas, Jesus was questioned. Peter tried to find out what was happening, but was given away by his Galilean accent. What happened next? It may well be that Caiaphas, hearing that Jesus had been camping out with an armed band willing to use force, decided there was enough here for Pilate. So Jesus was sent to Pilate's headquarters on the west side of the city to await a summary hearing in the morning.
Here, at dawn, at Pilate's headquarters, Jesus was sentenced to death. It was Pilate's habit to be in Jerusalem at festival time with a strong contingent of soldiers to deal with any trouble. Now, if the religious authorities saw Jesus as a religious problem, Pilate simply saw him as another Galilean agitator, a political problem. Pilate knew exactly what should be done with Galilean messiahs.
So Jesus was led out to an unknown site west or north of the city. Since crucifixion was meant to be seen, it was probably a hill or mound by the roadside. No disciples saw it, and only odd details survive. A man named Simon was made to carry the crossbeam because Jesus was exhausted. The title or notice read, "The King of the Jews." As for Jesus' last words, it said he recited the psalm, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? My God, why hast thou forsaken me?"
After his death, a devout Jew saw to it that Jesus' remains received decent traditional burial in a rock tomb like this one. So ended his earthly career. What happened next? According to the Gospels, the women who came to anoint Jesus' body found the tomb empty. Many people find it difficult to dismiss that story outright, because if it's a fabrication, the early Christians would surely have invented something more convincing. The mere absence of a body suggests simply that it's been stolen, and that's what some people said at the time. But the body was never produced. Nevertheless, the real meaning of the resurrection is not here. Why seek the living among the dead? By enduring to the end, by completely living his own message, Jesus had attained the kingdom. God had enthroned him as Lord and Christ. He was no longer plain Jesus of Nazareth, the prophet. He was the Lord Jesus Christ. And that meant that the faith in the kingdom of God wasn't destroyed by Jesus' death. It was stronger than ever. Now the identity of the coming king was known. Jesus would return. That is the meaning of the resurrection. And it had two important effects. In the first place, it gave rise to intense religious experiences, visions of the exalted Lord, which lasted for several years and affected several hundred people. But more than that, it transformed his followers' memory of Jesus.
Now his whole life began to be seen as a fulfillment of Scripture and as prefiguring his future glory. His birth had been attended by angels, and his baptism by a voice from heaven. On these waters he had stilled the storm and fed a multitude on the shore. Now that the secret of his true identity was revealed, the past was transformed. The gospel tradition was taking shape. It was not just history, but a revelation of the divine meaning of Jesus' life. Returning to Galilee after the resurrection, the disciples could see him as having walked and as still walking upon this lake, like God whose footsteps are in the great waters. When we were talking about the historical Jesus, we tried to be objective, to weigh every statement carefully, and to produce a picture that I think most scholars would broadly endorse. But from now on, things get more difficult. We run into controversies in which I'm personally involved. From now on, we're not being objective in quite the same sense that we have been so far. Jesus had no thought of founding a new religion. He hoped to see the final fulfillment of an old one. But after his death, the end was apparently delayed. And the church, at first just a little group of people waiting for his return, gradually turned into an enormous historical institution, the Gentile Church, teaching doctrines about Jesus which he himself knew nothing of. In order to set the stage for today's controversies, let's pick out, with the help of Christian art, some of the main themes in the history of what Jesus has been in the Christian imagination. The step that created the Christian community was the recognition of Jesus as Messiah. In Greek, Christos, Christ. So central was this idea that the first two letters of Christos make up one of the earliest Christian symbols. The church's message was still very Jewish. There were no very clear ideas of the pre-existence or the divinity of the Messiah. Knowledge of the Old Testament was presupposed, and the end of the present era was expected very soon. As a result, Christianity at first spread through the Jewish dispersion. By AD 100, Christian groups existed at these sites. The ancient world was turning away from the old gods of polytheism, and there was a longing for renewal. Some looked to philosophy, some to the exotic mystery religions. But others looked to the Jews. The Jews responded by translating their scriptures into Greek and their belief and ethics into Gentile thought forms. They made many converts. After the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70, Christians and Jews steadily drew apart. Thereafter, Christianity developed alone and quickly became Hellenized. The long line of Christian images of Jesus begins with this Greek theme of him as an Arcadian shepherd. Such images were privately produced and unofficial. Another patron could see Jesus as a philosopher, pointing the way to a Greek heaven. Meanwhile, St. Paul had shaped early Christian ideas of salvation. What was needed was union with Christ by baptism. The earliest surviving Christian font in Syria is shaped like a tomb set against the wall. It's a place of death and rebirth to a new risen life. The earliest Christians had no standard iconography. They stuck to the Jewish ban on representations of the divine, but they used various symbols like the fish. There was still no fixed image of Christ, and they had no crucifixes or cult of his humanity. They didn't pray directly to him or say flatly that he was God. Their main emphasis was on sacramental union with the heavenly Christ. For in the risen life, the Christian was fed by the bread of heaven. Here, the fish symbolizes Christ in the Eucharist. Even in the days of persecution, the Eucharist was celebrated with some splendor. This 4th century church silver, found recently near Peterborough, is the oldest known. It's remarkable that in the remotest part of the empire, what was still a minority sect should be able to produce such fine objects. In the 4th century, Christianity became the established faith of the Roman Empire. The pagan emperor cult, which the first Christians had died rather than acknowledge, was now refocused on Christ, the true emperor. He was given the royal halo, the vestments of a priest king, and was enthroned over the cosmos. The Galilean Jesus had become the guarantor of the very same state power that had crucified him. Churches were now built as throne rooms, and Christian ritual was remodeled on court ritual. The higher clergy were awarded the insignia of civil service rank, which they still wear. At the top of the cosmic order, Christ was flanked by his apostles, and Mary, the Dowager Empress of Heaven, was attended by virgin martyrs. Corresponding to them on earth were the various ranks in church and state, the bishop and his presbyters, the emperor and empress, with their attendants. For the sake of religious peace, the emperors encouraged great councils of bishops to define orthodox doctrine. The doctrine of Christ was fixed at Chalcedon in AD 451. In the Lord Jesus Christ, it was said, are two complete natures, divine and human, distinct but united in the one person of God's eternal Son. Where Jesus had been young and it seemed somewhat tempestuous, the face of the church's Christ became old, severe, and bearded, embodying the Greek ideal of apatheia, passionlessness. God, in the Greek view, has no feelings, so the face of the incarnate God becomes calm and radiant with uncreated light. The events of his life, which were chosen as subjects for Christian art, were those like the Transfiguration, which were most revealing of his true divine identity. At the same time, the cult of Christ's humanity also developed. People began to pray to Christ, to venerate his human body. They called his mother the Mother of God. Here is the basis of Christian humanism. By the time of the Italian Renaissance, the life of Jesus in art had become a grand pageant, a series of theological tableaux. They exhibit Jesus' life as the epiphany of the God-man in time. Many of the scenes have little historical content and are rather indifferent to historical accuracy. Their detail depends on Christian iconography rather than on the gospel text. They communicate church doctrine in a symbolic code, and they're mostly linked to holy days in the Christian year, like Good Friday. Not only Jesus, but God the Father himself had become locked up in the church and its doctrines. In this woodcut of the Trinity, made in 1511, Dürer followed common practice and represented God the Father as the Pope, wearing the triple crown. In Martin Luther's challenge to the church, beginning in 1517, there was a demand for a more immediate kind of religion, the Protestant Reformation. When printed New Testaments became freely available, they helped satisfy this need. Every literate man now had his own way to God through reading the scriptures for himself and in his own language. In 1519, Dürer, still a Catholic, portrayed the Last Supper like this. The manner is still dramatic, Italian, and traditional, and the symbols of sacrifice, the knife and the slain lamb, are conspicuous on the table. 4 years later, Dürer's sympathy for Protestantism was clear. The plate now lies empty on the floor, and the table is swept bare, except for the cup of fellowship. This is a sober, attentive meal. For Catholicism, Christ was mediated through the Church, and in particular through the action of the Mass, which brought Calvary into the present moment. The true Church of Protestantism was invisible. Each believer was guided by God's Spirit as he read God's Word for himself. The center of religion became the individual's inner relation to Christ. Jesus was ceasing to be seen as a majestic and awesome God-man. His image, as in this painting by Rembrandt, is more that of an individual human being, an elder brother or alter ego. But above all, Jesus was Savior. In the evangelical message of John Wesley and men like him, the conversion experience became the central theme of preaching. It aimed to produce a refocusing of the self upon the figure of Jesus. This kind of religion is very intense and biblicist, yet it's distinctly different from what Jesus himself had stood for. A kind of humanist cult of personality increasingly replaces Jesus' own God-centered outlook. The 19th century inherited this paradox of fervent devotion to Jesus combined with a curiously false image of him. The Victorian Jesus, knocking with quiet persistence at the locked door of the human heart, looks like a projection of the reproachful Victorian conscience. The image has declined and gone soft. Many saw something morbid and subjective in the piety of the period. At the very end of the Victorian age, the standard Christian images of Jesus were suddenly overthrown by Albert Schweitzer and others. They had no basis in history. The real Jesus had been a strange Jewish prophet of the kingdom of God. So in the present century, many leading theologians have agreed that Jesus belonged to Judaism, not to modern Christianity, that we don't know very much about him, and that what we do know suggests that he was dominated by apocalyptic ideas impossible for us to accept. Theology now begins not from the message of Jesus, but from the experience of salvation and the Christ of church doctrine. But when the Christ of the Church is no longer firmly rooted in the real Jesus, he comes to be projected in a different way in each cultural setting. Many still think the quest for the historical Jesus has failed. But the Christ of the Church, they think, is a greater figure anyway. They prefer the flamboyant Christ of faith. The modern church seems to have left the historical Jesus far behind. This is scarcely the real Jesus. It's a Christ of faith, which no longer expresses the values Jesus himself stood for. On the whole, the churches, and not only the Catholic Church, have decided that they prefer to cling to traditional doctrine and piety. But if the Jesus of history were to be taken seriously again, would not church doctrine have to be reconsidered? So an image of Jesus like this stands at the tail end, the rather sad tail end, of a long process of historical development. As we've seen in the story we've just told, the image of Jesus as the God-man was firmly developed by about 400 AD, reigned supreme for 1,000 years and more, and then after the Reformation became more human, and since has gradually declined to this. Well, not surprisingly, in the present century, there's fierce argument between conservatives who want to reaffirm traditional doctrine and various sorts of radical. In 1977, controversy broke out over this book, The Myth of God Incarnate. I was one of the 7 contributors. We say different things, but my own view is that it's worth sacrificing a good deal of traditional orthodoxy if the values and outlook of the real Jesus can be restored to the center of Christianity. However, 2 months later, a very sharp counterblast appeared from people who attacked both our arguments and our assumptions, the truth of God incarnate. Its contributors included Brian Hebblethwaite, Bishop Butler, and Canon Michael Green of Oxford. Michael Green stands in the evangelical tradition, stressing the Bible, the believer's personal relationship with Jesus, and the reality of the resurrection.
If the bones of Jesus Christ are rotting in some cave in Jerusalem, I believe that Christianity could be shown to be false. Jews didn't believe in vague spiritual beings hovering around. That's not what they were saying when they were claiming the resurrection of Jesus. They were saying that what was expected of all God's people on the last day, resurrection to a new quality of life, had actually happened in this one man. And if that could be disproved, if the resurrection could be disproved, then I think that would be the end of Christianity. But it cannot be disproved. And what's more, there is this experience of the risen Christ, which goes alongside the historical evidence. And these are the two pillars on which the Christian faith goes. Jesus is the center of my life. He is the one who met with me as a boy, the Jesus of the New Testament. I believed that, you know, he was there in the Bible. I believed that this was true, but it meant nothing to me until I saw that on that cross, he dealt with my self-centeredness and badness. Until I saw that he rose again from the dead and that he was alive and therefore I could meet him. And I entrusted my life to him, and that's 20 years and more ago now, but it grows more and more real all the time. And I've seen him changing lives through this proclamation of the New Testament Christianity, the plain, unvarnished New Testament Christianity. I've seen him changing lives all over the world, in every culture, every religious background. And I honestly don't think there is a divide between the Jesus of history and the Christ of faith. I believe that they're substantially the same. And it is this Jesus to whom I've committed myself and who was made real to me by the Spirit of the living Christ, who is the possession of all Christian believers.
Another standpoint represented in The Truth of God Incarnate is the Roman Catholic view of Christ based on Scripture as interpreted by the Church, whose bishops define doctrine in general councils. Bishop Butler of Westminster is a well-known Catholic New Testament scholar.
I think that where perhaps Catholics are in a slightly, take a slightly different attitude from non-Catholics in this matter, is that many non-Catholics would put their money on the results of biblical scholarship as the foundation of what they ultimately believe about Jesus, or might seem to do so. I think the Catholic, by disposition and by training and conviction, would rest his case about the religious significance of Jesus on something rather wider than merely the results of biblical criticism. If you turn to the Gospels, or rather to what the modern scholarship, on the whole, agrees, because the methods of modern scholarship are fairly well accepted nowadays, on the whole, tells us about the historical Jesus, you will, at first sight, feel that you're being presented with a very defective picture compared with the Jesus that Christians have been worshipping for 2,000 years. And it's easy to ask oneself, well, what is the difference? Why is the difference? I think the real answer to the difference is that the historical Jesus, ex hypothesi, leaves out the resurrection of Jesus. Once you really believe in the resurrection, you've got to look back, and the early church looked back, to our Lord's own person, his behavior, his teaching, his sufferings, and see them all in a new light. And it was out of the conviction of the resurrection, and a Christian would say, with the assistance of the Holy Spirit, of course, that this added aspect came in, so that the church finds itself believing and proclaiming that Jesus, while perfect man, is also divine, that he is, well, to use technical English Christian language, he's the second person of the Holy Trinity, that he's God of God, and of the same substance, that is to say, of the same being as his Heavenly Father. And so you get into the whole mystery of the Holy Trinity, of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, each God, neither of them the other, and yet there's only one God. Paradoxes multiply at that point. But that doesn't worry me, because paradoxes seem to me to multiply at the extreme edges of physical science, too. I suppose that for a person in 1977 who believes in this Christian orthodoxy, this faith in Jesus means just everything. Jesus is not for him just a figure in past history, but he's a living reality who is with him as his companion, his inspiration, his guide, and his access to the ultimate mystery day by day, moment by moment. So life is completely transformed, if you can believe this thing.
The debate between conservatives and radicals centers on the questions, is Jesus God? And is the incarnation, God's becoming man, the essential Christian belief? Here in Cambridge, I've been disputing publicly and privately with Brian Hebblethwaite, Dean of Queen's College, another Anglican contributor to the truth of God incarnate.
If we're serious about the idea of incarnation, it really means a real human life that was lived out from a center in God for our salvation, and that matters, that it's a real human life. But it equally matters, it matters just as much, that it's the divine life here in our midst. That seems to me to be the point of Christianity, which you're missing out on.
As I see it, in the Gospels, he's presented as a man filled with God's Spirit, given an extraordinary destiny to be the Messiah, fighting out, if you like, a terrific battle between God and man. He's at the center of the storm. There's no doubt he has a very strong sense of destiny. And as I see it, through his strivings and ultimately through his death, salvation comes. But none of this seems to necessitate the idea of his equal divinity. Do you think Jesus himself or his immediate disciples could have thought of him as God?
I think that's a very difficult one. I don't think Jesus was, thought of himself as the second person of the Trinity, no. God's presence amongst us has to be channeled through real first century Jewish humanity that expresses itself in the kind of consciousness of God which someone brought up by a Jewish rabbi would have.
But now the incarnation is getting so mysterious, it's vanishing altogether. If Jesus doesn't know he's God, and he doesn't actually wield divine power as he walks about, in what sense is he God?
Well, the authority with which he speaks, the implicit claims in his actions, certainly go a long way beyond what any other human prophet or human saint does or achieves.
But none of these prove his divinity.
No. I'm quite prepared to allow that. The proof of his divinity, it doesn't come from a reading of his claims. It comes from an understanding of the impact of his risen presence on the early Christians and on Christians down the ages.
But even the resurrection doesn't prove Jesus' divinity. After all, you get Elijah taken up to heaven. There's an ascension story about Elijah. And in the Transfiguration, Elijah is seen alive again after his death. So even the resurrection doesn't actually prove Jesus' divinity.
Well, if one's set on looking for that kind of proof, I suspect one's looking in the wrong direction. One has to judge this thing certainly partly by the ability of the evidence to sustain this way of looking at things, but chiefly by the moral and religious sense which it makes in the experience of Christians down the ages, it seems to me.
But the kind of doctrine you're putting forward seems to me to go so far that one can't but lose touch with the historical Jesus. Now, I give the historical Jesus unique authority just because he's so apocalyptic, just because he stands at the end of the world and says, how are we ultimately before God? I think you're stuck with church Christianity and you've forgotten that the church exists only for the sake of the kingdom of God.
Yeah, but we have to know whose kingdom and who the God is we're talking about. And the church has certainly gone on to spell out in more detail who God is and how we see God as a result of his gift of himself to us in Christ. And that's not to reduce the thing, it's to spell it out in more detail. And it's not an obscure, highfalutin doctrine, this doctrine of the Incarnation. I think that it brings God very close to ordinary people if they can see him there in their midst in this man. Certainly, the humanity has to be stressed and brought out, the real human struggles of Jesus, the real temptations, the real sorrows and joys, because it's all this humanity, real humanity, when construed as God's humanity in our midst, that gives the point to Christian faith in God.
Well, I'm a little bit worried about this process of drawing out the implications, because it doesn't seem to be a matter of strict logic. It seems to be a matter of building a very complicated superstructure, rather like the pearl growing round that little seed and getting bigger and bigger and bigger, until eventually the one who started the whole thing off is lost and hidden. I mean, think of an icon that's overpainted and overpainted until the original icon just isn't there anymore. Now, I feel this has happened with Jesus, and that it is vitally necessary to get back to the original message of Jesus himself and face it again.
I think
why don't you agree?
No, well, because I don't think that's the only control. I mean, I do think we have to go back to the historical Jesus, perfectly true, and it's no good coming up with a doctrine which forgets about him and regards him as inessential. We do have to go back there, but we also have another control in that the thing is a living religion. It's a matter of living personal relation to the risen Lord.
Now, in the second and third centuries, a great variety of views about Jesus were tolerated, but after the great dogmas were defined, Christianity became more ideological, more dogmatic, and the sort of views I hold were really ruled out. People started getting expelled. But would you admit that the kind of views I held were held by some people in the first 200 or 300 years before dogmatic definition was completed?
Yes, I think that's true. And I think it's perfectly possible for the church to be much more tolerant of who it will include nowadays than it was in the fifth century. I wouldn't want to unchurch anyone who finds Jesus Christ a drawing, attractive power in any kind of way. And I'm quite sure we can tolerate and work along with people with all sorts of different ideas. But I'm still not prepared to say they're all equally good or equally viable.
Yes, but would you not agree that the cult of Jesus can sometimes actually obscure the reality of God? People pray to God, pray to Jesus, they worship Jesus and so on, in a way that can obscure the fact that Jesus himself was completely God-centered. Jesus himself didn't want a cult of personality centered on himself. He repeatedly tries to play that down or stop people from focusing on him. He points away from himself to God.
Yes, a Jesus cult can get detached from God, and that's wrong. But I don't see anything wrong in worship of Jesus as the human face of God, so long as Jesus is thought of as the channel, the human presence of God in our midst, then worship of Jesus seems to me to be perfectly all right.
Are you willing to use a phrase like the humanity of God, as some theologians have used it?
I think that's a very reasonable way of talking about Jesus Christ.
Yes, it horrifies me. I do think that there has been a gradual drift from Christianity to humanism, and that some of these doctrines have facilitated that drift, and that for the restoration or the recovery of belief in God, it's vital to reassert the disjunction between man and God.
Yeah, that horror of yours is quite opaque to me. I just don't understand it. I just can't think what you're thinking of, really, because it seems to me that you have failed to see the moral and religious point of incarnation, of God's coming close to us out of his great love. Why should this cause horror? What is this this picture of the transcendence of God that that you're trying to get back to? The more you talk like that, the more I feel that God has become quite alien and different and unworshipable, let alone unlovable.
Well, the argument's going to go on for a long time yet. And it's not for me to sum up at this stage. You must decide what you make of what you've heard. But some things we do see more clearly than we used to see them in the past. The man who made this figure thought that he was just portraying Jesus. Well, he wasn't. This is Jesus as seen through the eyes of Christendom. Look at the figure. It's got the Roman Emperor's halo. It's got the body of a Greek god. It's got a twist of Gothic emotion from the Middle Ages, and it's all seen through Victorian eyes. Well, Christendom was a product of history, and now it's getting overgrown with the passage of time. Yet Jesus himself, in a curious way, transcends history. Just because he was so apocalyptic, he took up a position outside history, at the very end of the world, where we're confronted by the reality of God. In that moment, he envisaged a radical transformation of the self and of the world order, a moral and religious vision which even yet we don't fully understand. So whatever happens to Christendom, Jesus himself will go on being as fascinating as ever.